glad to see each one of you here this morning. Thank you for being here. We're also, we have a special guest today. I'd like to introduce to you Reverend Eli Rolon Jeong. He's on the staff with the region, and he will help us. He's visiting from the Chicago area, and he'll help us with our, deliver our message today and also the installation service piece. Are there any other announcements that we should be aware of today? Seeing none, I guess let's stand as you're comfortably able and join in our opening hymn, Be Thou My Vision, number 595. Join in our call to worship. The season of Lent sets us on a journey.
The journey begins in the wilderness.
We follow the way of Jesus, who faced trials, trouble, temptation, and testing.
Like Jesus, we are not alone. The Holy Spirit is with us. God's word is on our lips.
Our call is to trust in God alone, to do God's will in all things. Let us pray. All-knowing and all-caring God, we gather this day, drained by another week. We are like a parched desert, empty and in need of replenishment. Visit us with your presence, saturate us with your spirit, and bathe us in your streams of living water, that our lives might acknowledge and worship you to the praise and honor of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. I'm going to read today's scripture, which is found in the Epistle to the Romans, chapter 10, verses 11 to 15. The scripture says, "No one who believes in him will be put to shame, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." I want to start by saying that it is an absolute blessing to be here with you this morning. I am excited for you, 15th Avenue Christian Church, and for your newly called pastor, Reverend Mike Kindred. Pastor Mike, I am honored to officially welcome you into our region, the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ in Illinois and Wisconsin. I bring greetings and blessings on behalf of our regional staff. I hope and pray that God's abundant blessing fall upon you, Pastor Mike, and upon this congregation, and that it fills all of you to the highest capacity. Amen. Today we have cause for joy and celebration. I know that the leaders of this congregation have worked very faithfully and diligently these past couple of years in search and preparation for a new minister to lead you as a congregation. Calling and now installing Pastor Mike is a milestone in your congregational life, one that without a doubt is worthy of recognition and celebration as we are doing here today. Today's scripture gives us an insight into our Christian faith. I also find that today's scripture gives us a reminder of what it is to be called into ministry. And so I think these few verses from Romans fits very well with our installation and celebration today. We find today's scripture in the middle of the Apostle Paul's theological wrestling with salvation. Paul is distraught because he feels that many are looking for righteousness in the law instead of trying to understand righteousness through faith in Christ Jesus. In verse 9 of Romans 10, just before the part that I just read a few minutes ago, Paul says that we are saved through the faith that we proclaim. He says, "Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." About 10 years ago, I helped organize a conference for young adult disciples. One of the questions that we presented as a theme for the week was, "Who is God for you?" The goal of this question was to provoke us to think deeply about our relationship with God, as well as our relationship with Jesus, the gospel, and even our relationship with one another. As I'm sure you know, answering who God is for me can be rather complex when we start digging deeper and deeper. The week-long retreat was filled with enriching conversations about our faith journeys and about our work in Christian ministry. It was interesting to hear how everyone related to God's word in unique yet familiar ways. But there was a moment towards the end of our week that it really hit me. I recall something one of our participants said very clearly, and it stayed with me until this day. He said that ultimately, it doesn't matter who you and me say God is, but rather what's important is how the rest of the world see God in us. His point was not to say that we can't formulate an understanding of who God or Jesus might be for us. That's actually something worthwhile for us to do. Answering who God is for us does help us continue developing spiritually, and it helps build our faith. But it doesn't really matter how we describe God and Jesus in our lives, for if everyone else cannot see us living into that understanding. We can say whatever we want about God. It can be something beautifully said, something that sounds like we have figured it out. And yet, no matter how wise or precise we sound, the world is not going to care about what we say if they cannot see God through us. And that, I believe, is part of the core of what it means for us to live into our faith as we do Christian ministry. And as we wrestle ourselves with the words of Paul, we find that this faith which he speaks of, the type of faith that leads us toward salvation, is an embodied faith. Paul here says that this faith is carried through our lips and our hearts. It is carried through our mouth and even our feet. It is an embodied faith. It is the type of faith that needs to be not only spoken, but also requires that it be heartfelt. And the type of faith that moves us to connect with one another. It is the type of faith that is not simply about speaking who Christ might be, but also living into who Christ is. As a biblical commentator say, the way for believers to explain God to those who have not heard is not through theological brilliance, scriptural proof, or doctrine and dogma. Instead, it is living out the word that is within and doing that in a way that makes sense. The epistle to the Romans, even just a few verses that we read in chapter 10, provide a fertile ground for theological discussion. There's much that we can explore and wrestle with regarding salvation, faith, the law, and much more. It is a passage that can engender a fruitful conversation that could easily take days, if not weeks and months, to unpack and understand. But for now, I want to focus on one aspect of ministry that I lift from these few verses in Romans 10. And I think that they're important for a day such as today, something that is very fitting for today's installation and celebration of Pastor Mike here at 15th Avenue Christian Church. It is actually a very practical answer to the question presented here by Paul. How are they to hear? How are they to hear about the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ? Paul says it is necessary to have faith in Christ Jesus, but how is someone to develop such faith? Someone has to share about Jesus, and not only share by simply uttering words, but by living out God's word. But who might that be? Well, here I have a simple answer. Pastor Mike is going to tell them. Friends, again, I believe that what ministry is about, and it is what we're celebrating here today. You have called on Pastor Mike to lead you in ministry. He is someone called to build relationships with you, called to walk with you as you continue strengthening your faith in Christ. In many ways, an installation is an extension of a minister's ordination. I was blessed to be a part of Pastor Mike's ordination service last fall. Ordination is a call into ministry as someone who has dedicated their life to serve God, especially in a way that provides leadership and mentorship to others. And while Pastor Mike's ordination means that he is called to be a minister wherever he might find himself, today's installation is an official recognition of Pastor Mike's call to be a minister specifically to all of you here in Rock Island at this congregation. Now, it is true that Pastor Mike has been called out to serve as minister, but he's not the only one called to do this. There's a second part to this answer. This time, the answer is also all of you. They are to hear about the good news of Jesus because you are going to tell them. 15th Avenue Christian Church, you reach out to Pastor Mike and you have called him to be in relationship with you. But reaching out does not stop here. It is constant work, and it happens as we all continue being in ministry together. I know you're God's people doing God's work, and with Pastor Mike as your new minister, I know you will continue faithfully strengthening relationships with one another and with your neighbors so they may know your faith in Christ. Simply, this installation is an invitation to join together in ministry. It is a covenant, an official recognition of that mutual invitation of ministry together. 15th Avenue Christian Church, Pastor Mike has now been with you for a few weeks. You already extend an invitation and have welcomed Mike to join as your pastor so that he may share his gift of ministry with you. I hope and pray that this ministry blesses all of you. I hope it flourishes and nourishes each of you and everyone around you. Remember, you are embodying your faith in Jesus. Remember, you are living out God's word. You are doing this, as Paul encourages all of us to do. Again, the last verse that we read today in chapter 10, verse 15 says, "And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news." Pastor Mike and 15th Avenue Christian Church, you have been sent together to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. May your feet continue to be the beautiful feet that brings good news. Amen.
As chair of the search committee of 15th Avenue Christian Church, I am pleased to present Reverend Mike Kindred for installation as our pastor. I invite the regional minister to lead us in the covenant that will bind us to one another.
In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the sovereign of the church, and in the presence of God, we now enter into the covenant of installation between Reverend Mike Kindred and 15th Avenue Christian Church. To seal and bless the joining together of this whom God has called to be the shepherd in the church, and this congregation whom God has called to be God's loving and faithful family, is a moment of sacred presence. The vows which I, as a regional pastor of ministers and churches in the Christian Church of Illinois and Wisconsin, shall call each of you to undertake in the presence of God, shall bind you into covenant for life and ministry in this place. Reverend Mike Kindred, will you please stand? Well, you're already standing. Sorry, I'm reading. Reverend Mike Kindred, do you acknowledge your baptismal vow that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God?
I do.
Do you reaffirm your ordination vow through which you, of your own free will, took upon yourself the obligation, responsibilities, and disciplines of the office of an ordained minister of Jesus Christ, and through which you promised to serve the church in the name of God by loving its members, caring for them, nurturing them, sustaining them, and equipping them for the service of God?
I do.
Will the elders please stand if you're able? Do you acknowledge the holy responsibilities of the office of elder for which you have been chosen to love and sustain this congregation whose spiritual welfare you have in your care? Do you solemnly covenant together with this pastor to work in love and harmony as Christ has commanded to oversee and encourage the spiritual growth of the congregation so that you may be the church as God intended? Will the deacons please stand if you're able? Do you acknowledge the holy responsibilities of the office of deacon for which you have been chosen to serve this congregation whose material affairs you have in your care?
Yes, deacon.
Do you solemnly covenant together with this pastor to work in common service for the good of the congregation and that the church might grow in ministry and witness? And now, please, will the members of the church board please stand? Do you acknowledge the particular responsibilities of your office in this church, and do you affirm your love and devotion to this congregation whose life you serve? Do you solemnly covenant with this pastor to work with him in love and harmony as Christ has commanded, faithfully performing those duties assigned to you so that this congregation may grow in obedience to our Lord? Will the congregation please stand as you're able? Do you individually acknowledge your baptismal vow that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and your obligation to serve Christ as your sovereign and Savior? Do you solemnly covenant together with this pastor to work with him in love and harmony as commanded by our Lord to fulfill the mission that Christ has laid upon us in this congregation, in this community, and throughout the world? Will you faithfully accomplish with this pastor those ministries that may be asked of you according to your gifts and spaces? If so, please say, I do. Will you share with me in the litany of God's call? And you can find that on your bulletin insert. We wait for you, Spirit of God. Like Moses and Miriam before us, we have accepted your call to lead your children towards freedom. We wait for your Spirit now to show us the way.
Like Ruth and Jeremiah before us, we have accepted your call to risk.
Like Mary Magdalene and John the Baptist before us, we have accepted your call to bear witness to the good of life. We wait for your Spirit to lead us in word and action.
Like all your children before us, we have accepted your call to establish your church in the heavens. We wait for your Spirit to enable our ministry.
Guiding, empowering Spirit, we wait upon your silent breath that gives life to our faith, that makes active our love, that emboldens our commitment, and that gives direction to our work.
We wait with longing, Spirit of God. Come quickly to be in us. Amen.
Mike, do you now declare that it is your desire to serve 15th Avenue Christian Church as its pastor in love and faithfulness to God?
I do.
Do you therefore covenant together with this people of God to be a good shepherd by loving them, teaching them, nurturing them, sustaining them, and equipping them so that by God's strength and grace, you and this congregation may faithfully accomplish God's mission for the salvation of all persons to the glory of God and not our own?
I do.
Pastor Mike and 15th Avenue Christian Church, will you join together in the prayer of consecration? O most virtuous Spirit,
may we be enjoined together this day in living out a shared ministry which emulates the life and witness of Christ. May we covenant in holy bond to love each other, to agree to disagree, to restrain from speaking unkindly of others, and to avoid all forms of unfaithfulness. Bless our covenant as we minister together and seek to nurture harmony as pastor and congregation. May we witness your gifts in one another. May we grow together in joy and wisdom as we venture forth praising your Spirit. Amen.
Because of the covenantal vows now made and blessed, as I, regional minister of the Christian Church Disciples of Christ in Illinois and Wisconsin and Michigan, in the name of Jesus Christ, the sovereign of the church, do hereby declare you, Reverend Michael Kindred, to be the pastor of 15th Avenue Christian Church. Glad to have you here.
Thank you.
your hearts up to the Lord. Let us pray. Almighty God, we rejoice that you have called us to be your people in this time and place. Help us to fulfill the mission you call us to, even as we seek to know what faithfulness requires of us. Strengthen the resolves that have been made here, and uplift your leaders with hope and encouragement, that they may endure every difficulty and rejoice in every blessing. Fill this congregation with your loving spirit, that each may work together in harmony, so that all members may work together for the common good and to your glory. We pray for those who are sick among us. We believe that you are the great physician, and that you can bring peace and comfort to those who need healing in body, mind, and spirit. We pray for our world, lifting up especially those who are suffering in and fleeing from the war in Ukraine. Lord, we ask for relief for those who are trapped in violence, especially for the children who are being separated from their homes and families. And we pray for leaders everywhere that they will know what to do in the complexity of our war-torn world. And we remember especially today those on our prayer list, asking for a special touch for those who have been added in recent days. God of grace, you know each need, and you care about each person. We lift them up to you now, trusting that each one with their unique needs and circumstances will find peace and healing in your merciful and gracious presence. Eternal God, hear the vows we have made to one another this morning. Strengthen us to carry out the work laid before us. Gather the varied fibers of our being and fashion us into a living tapestry of loving service, a community in the world, witnessing to your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Inspire our witness to him that all may know the power of his forgiveness and the hope of his resurrection. We pray in Jesus' name, the one who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
If we confess that Jesus is our Lord, what does that mean? Are these just words, or do our lives' actions reflect the saving grace of our Lord? Let us bring our gifts to God so that through their use, others may come to confess Jesus as Lord. The deacons will now collect our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
God, who pours out his love to all people, we bring these gifts to you today and ask your blessings on them. We pray that those who receive these gifts through the work of your church will experience the power of your love. We confess with our lips that you are Lord. We confess through these gifts that you are Lord of our lives. Amen. As we gather around this table, we proclaim the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. We are here at this moment because we believe that God's Son was sent to us that we might be saved. The breaking of bread and the drinking of this cup are simple acts in remembrance of a more important action of the God who calls us by name. How does one accept such a gift as salvation? All too often we feel uncomfortable when someone gives us something that does not ask for anything in return. At this table, we witness and experience the breadth and depth of God's love. We believe that God's Son was sent to us that we might know life and live it abundantly. Now open our hearts to receive this gift. Open our minds to understand the power of this gift. Open our lips and confess with one voice, Jesus is Lord. Please join in singing our communion hymn number 393.
received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Let's pray. Gracious God, every time and place, every people and nation, we come to this table to receive these symbols of your grace, your hope, and your sustenance. We come grateful that you feed us and call on us to help feed one another. Thank you, O Lord. We pray that you would bless these elements to our good, that we might join you in spreading good news to this weary world. May we go from this table refreshed and renewed. In the holy name of Christ we pray. Amen.
King, how beautiful the hand
invite those who would like to join the church to come forward during the singing of the invitation hymn. And that hymn is Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, number 517.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.